Serious, those of you who worked undercover, what is the most taboo thing you witnessed, but could not intervene as to not blow your cover? Worked as a ghost passenger for an airline. Basically, I flew around and graded flight attendants' performance. While still parked at the gate with the door open, one flight attendant began berating passengers who were using their smartphones, which was completely permitted at the gate. She threatened to have the person in front of me thrown off the plane if she didn't put hers away. She also threatened me. After we left the gate and were taxiing to the runway, I looked back to see her sitting in her jump seat, using her phone. Took a photo of it and included that in my report. She initially denied using the phone and claimed I was being unruly on the aircraft. After she saw the photo, she changed her tune. Working as a secret shoplifter for a large retail chain. I would basically test loss prevention and see what I could get out of a store. The total would be tallied up and taken off the store manager's bonus. So they had to be on their game. One thing I used to do was steal copper or electrical cable sold by the foot. I would drag it to the fence and spool it up in my car, parked on the other side. This was fun to me and an obvious catch for the store. I go outside to the wire rack and there is a store manager getting a blowjob from a cashier. They spotted me and quickly went back inside to leave me alone. I then went ahead and spooled out the wire as planned. Not one but the entire inventory, to the point my car started to get lower under the weight. I went in and bought something and went to the cashier I saw with the SM. I asked her how long she had been there. She replied, "For a couple of weeks now, it's just part time until I go back to high school for my junior year." I then went back to the SM and identified myself and what I saw in private. The cashier was the daughter of a friend of his and is only 16. He was 37. I gave him 2 weeks to find another job or I would be back and blow it all up. He not only left in 1 week, but left the state entirely. Hindsight, I should have called the police, but I didn't. This was about 20 years ago. So I can answer this one. I do social engineering for financial institutions, banks, credit unions, etc. I went to a credit union in Texas where the entire place failed on a miserable basis for security. I walked in with a fake badge that stated I worked for a made-up company, and I was there to an inspection of a building. I dressed in a polo and khaki pants with matching colors to my badge, and walked into the front desk. The girl there was probably in college, or just out of school. She immediately let me into the back room and I walked into offices and desks that were unoccupied, but located in rooms with other employees. I walked up to empty computers in use and plugged USB drives in, huge no-no, and began typing random things into computers and taking pictures of myself at the computers. Employees would literally look at my and go back to their jobs without thinking anything of a guy taking selfies at their friend's work desk. Once I had been in every office, I went to the vice president's office and opened her desk and looked through files to find personal people's information. Found tons. I went into the file room and took personal loan documents off the shelf and took pictures of myself accessing them. When I was done, I walked to the person who had contracted my company and laid out all the information I had found and all the things I had done, and the guy just sighed. This scenario has happened a couple of different times. Most places fail somehow. Sometimes it's fun and interesting, sometimes it's boring, and there's nothing worth staying. Helped manufacture methocathinone so that I could get arrested with the suspects and spend time in the cells to discover how the drugs were being brought into the prisons. Was recruited due to my work circumstances, age, and environment. Had to change provinces when I was finished with the deal. I worked as a secret shopper for a while for a small store. The most egregious thing I found were employees would hide inventory if they knew a sale was coming up. I'd also go in and ask questions about what equipment I should use, just to test their general knowledge. Most failed, but they were young kids getting paid shit, so I felt bad squealing on them. I also forgot to add that I had to put up with being hit on by teenagers and creepy older guys. I had to play along and see if they knew their shit despite throwing terrible game. I work as a researcher studying illegal wildlife trade. In markets, I have seen critically endangered animals being sold openly for pretty low prices. I've also seen plenty of animals dead or dying in these markets with no food or water in the baking sun. But worse than that, I have friends who have had to watch Slellorizes, having their teeth pulled out with nail clippers, and not been able to do anything. I used to investigate insurance fraud. The one thing I saw that made me the maddest was when I was working in the rundown area near the Philly Zoo and saw a strung-out mother walking with her toddler and jerking his arm and screaming at him for not keeping up with her quick walking pace. The kid was not even 2 years old. I really wanted to get out of the car. The funniest one was where I had to go undercover in a bar to investigate this one person. You ever see the Stallone movie Over the Top? Yeah, that's pretty much what this guy ended up doing right on the bar, right in front of my hidden camera, and looking direct into my camera lens. It was awesome. The arm wrestling match went on 4 minutes and this bar guy too hurt to work. At times it was very entertaining to work undercover. Was secret shopping at a high-end restaurant, around $100 per plate. The busser came over and refilled my water glass that I had already drank out of and overfilled it, so he poured part back in the pitcher from my glass and proceeded to refill everyone else at the table from the same pitcher. I really wanted to throw a fit, but could only include it in my report. I worked for an armored car service for a while as an undercover guard. When a place had a lot of money, or if it was a risky area, two plainclothes guards would arrive before the truck. I would scout the place and outside to make sure the uniform guys could get in and out safe. We wore a color of the day and the local cops knew who we were, as did the uniformed guards. It was a pretty easy job and I only once waved off a pickup because of a bunch of Latin kings sitting on benches out front. I hung out a while to see what was going on and hoping they would leave so we could make the pickup. As I sat on a bus bench across the road, I watched one of the guys take out his needlepoint. I never would think that a gang member would tote his needlepoint to a stick-up job. I once took my vehicle to an independent shop for routine maintenance. I said I was dropping it off for as long as it might take, as I was going to take a long trip the following month. I sat across the street in a diner eating soup and drinking coffee. I got a call that my vehicle needed about $4,500 worth of work an hour and a half later. It never left the parking spot. I told them I didn't want anything done. They said it was half a part already. Fuck you, Firestone. I'm an assistant service manager at a dealership. That Firestone was turned into a parking lot. When I worked CAF for a video game publisher, they had me work an E3 as a secret player. Basically, I got to play new games for that publisher and act like they were amazing in front of press. While I was taking a break, I saw one of the producers hooking up with a booth babe. He didn't recognize me, but I knew he was married and had a kid on the way. I didn't say shit. He got laid off when the rest of us did about a year later. But that's just kinda how E3 goes. I'm so late to this party, but here it goes. I'm a TV producer. I was working on a popular documentary a while ago. We were following a woman who was addicted to heroin and had resorted to prostitution in order to make money to support her habits. One day, a friend of hers got thrown into jail. She decided she needed to work really hard to bail them out. So she called her friend who owned a crack house that he let girls like her turn tricks in at about $10 a pop. To answer Op's question, I witnessed this girl share needles with many people and watched as John after John came into the house and disappeared into the bedroom with her for a little bit. I really wish I had seen this earlier, so no doubt this will be buried, but here goes. For the first part of my adult life, I was an intel officer in the Air Force. On the outside world, I'm like a 6, but for the military, I'm a solid 9. I also am a pretty good talker and pretty outgoing. At my first duty station, I got invited to participate in a special DOD program where basically I was trained how to pick military guys up in a bar, ostensibly to see how well members of the armed forces were at keeping their mouths shut. My first few times going out were pretty non-eventful. I'd get super dolled up, approach guys who had more than likely never been hit on in their entire lives, and spend an evening chatting them up to see what I could get them to tell. For the most part, all of them were pretty good at keeping their mouths shut, and really the worst I ever heard was Cap so and so is such a dick, too bad he's cheating on his wife and his girlfriend. Very actionable intel if I had really been collecting on a unit or person. I think on one occasion I got a young officer to tell me some detailed parameters of some system or another, which got him in some serious trouble. I'm a private investigator. contracted by government to check massage shops to see if they are soliciting. I usually get sent to shops which have had multiple complaints and an investigation is in its final stages and they need evidence to support their case. So, I go to one place, everything seems normal except for being asked to strip bare for an oil massage. Eventually I'm asked to flip over, therapist without asking just starts rubbing some gel on my parts. At this point, I'm obligated to refuse and finish the session. I ask her to stop, but halfway through the sentence I'm hit with the most intense pain. Turns out, she was new, and was unaware that alcohol gel is not the same as massage oil. Long story short, manager was convicted of coercing staff on the basis of their visas being revoked if they didn't comply. And I had to stand in court and tell the events of that day. I was running a wire. We were looking to arrest a guy who beat a 2-year-old so bad she had broken femurs. We wired up mom and had her go to the boyfriend's house and try and get him to confess. Mom started out great, led the boyfriend along and started to fucking blow him. He then fucked her. The man who beat her daughter so bad she was life-lighted. She fucked him on wire. I was punching my dashboard and wishing I could arrest her as well. It was awful. From 2007 through 2008 I worked on a smuggling interdiction task force. My team dealt with human trafficking. My job was all bullshit, and I regret that we couldn't really do anything to put a dent in the problem. I worked undercover, in that I did not wear a uniform or carry a badge and my authority was civilian, so I only reported to Lee's. The most taboo thing I witnessed that I was not allowed to do anything about was women, mothers, aunts, grandmothers, offering children for sex in exchange for cash. The truth of the matter is that, at least in Western society, the threshold of evidence required to hold women responsible for sex trafficking is not even in the same ballpark as for men. The number of cases we had to tolerate sickens me. I don't know which we need to address first as a society, the rampant abuse, or the gender bias that keeps it going. But the truth be told, I met just as many women pimps and abusers as I did men. The biggest difference I could see is that women were more often pimping out the under 12 demographic versus the male pimps that were pimping out the teens. I never saw one female prosecuted, but we were successful in moving a handful of kids to foster care. Worked as a private investigator for a while. Mostly did work comp cases. Seen some shiftiness, drug deals, etc. Worst thing was conducting surveillance on a person at an apartment complex. Get there before light to set up my rig. Little bit before sunrise this Mexican couple, 50s-ish, in a truck pull up in front of my position. Guys pulling a trailer. Gets out rummage through dumpster for metal and stuff. Okay. Not so bad. Then the woman with him gets out in between my vehicle and said dumpster proceeds to pop a squat and shit on the ground. Way to start my morning, guys. Thanks. I worked as a HIPAA inspector for a bit. Shit is scary. I'd go in and say I was looking for my mom, that they called me, she was in an accident. I was early 20s. Pretty much every place I went gave me all kinds of protected info on the patient. The company would have placed fake records in the computer. One smaller urgent care place was like HM. No one with that name, here's our sign and log for the week. Take a look. With last names, first names and reason for visit. Yikes. Former loss prevention here. Best job ever, by the way. Witnessed so much sex in the stock rooms. Couples, singles, trios, you name it. We had cameras everywhere, of course, especially in the stockrooms due to rampant employee theft. We had countless hours of employee sex on tape. We couldn't reveal the cameras, which would tip off the thieves, so all we could do was watch.